Thank you very much. Thank you for the very kind invitation, for having me here. I feel really honored among these highly esteemed people. So my talk will be about the relationship between populism and liberal democracy from a rhetorical point of view. And I first start with a characterization of populism. Professor Latour already said it's a slippery concept. It's used and abused for political purposes. But as scholars, we want to understand it, so we have to have a definition or understanding, shared understanding of it. So populism in the literature has different meanings. I'm relying on Benjamin Moffett here, basically. So populism, I think the most dominant definition is populism as an ideology, a thin-centered ideology, as the Dutch social scientist Cas Mudde said. It is so thin in this description that you can really ask whether it's an ideology at all. It divides the society into groups, the real people, the good people versus the elite, the corrupt elite. And politics should be an expression of the general will of the people. And it's connected to other bigger, thicker ideologies like communism, socialism, fascism, conservatism. It's quite flexible in that regard. Second understanding is populism as a political strategy, a way that a personalistic, charismatic leader connects with people who are originally not organized or politically active. So it's a mobilization strategy. The third definition is also getting more and more popularity in the literature, is defended by Laclau and Chantal Mouffe, who will be here soon. Populism as a discourse or a discursive strategy. So a way to unite interested and bind people by dividing them in one group against the other, an antagonistic mechanism. And you can use it for a good purpose. If you are leftish, you can use it to construe a distinction between the we, the collective we, against the oligarchy. But it's done in by means of linguistic operations, so a chain of equivalences, themes that are connected, and so you can have a program, so to speak. The definition I support, and I think it is fruitful for understanding populism. There's some truth in all the definitions, but the best one, I think, is populism as a political style. It manifests itself through language, through to vision, performance. It's a kind of show. So you have populist discourse, which can be quite brutal, quite vulgar. It's described as a paranoid style, a man-in-the-street communication style, demagogic style, or a tabloid style in the literature. It appeals to our emotions and to our passions. It uses a broad repertoire of elements. So it's not really about content only, but a way to present content. It's a way of doing politics, as Knight calls it. So in this understanding, which I'm following, populism is not a black or white category. It comes in shades. It can be more or less populist. So when I'm talking about populism or populist politicians, I'm speaking about people or discourses who make use of radical figures connected to populism. And it stresses the importance of form. And the content is usually quite volatile. So in Western Europe, usually populist parties are right-wing parties focusing on immigration. They are anti-immigration. They are against the EU. And in other countries around the world, there are different issues, but they're, apart from these pet issues, they are quite flexible. So what are the formal features in this understanding of populism as a strategy, as a rhetorical strategy, is that you have this opposition between the real people versus the elites, the oligarchy, you can say the internal enemy, and you have also external enemies, the immigrants, asylum seekers in this understanding. What is very obvious in populist discourse, populist style, is the violation of codes, bad behavior, bad manners, bad language. So it's the high style versus the low style is as a way to distinguish yourself from the elite. So you speak a different language. You speak the language of people in the street instead of the scholarly academic language used by most politicians. And another formal feature is that in populist discourse, there is this sense of urgency, there's a crisis, a breakdown, and the West is going down, there's a threat, people are coming to our country, taking over, which calls for desperate measures. Some of the key issues are already mentioned, some, but connected to democracy. In populist discourse, you often find the idea that democracy is a direct presentation of the people's will. So there is no intermediary layer, no political parties, but there's one person who presents directly the people's will. There's a distrust of institutions, the parliament, the courts, media, European Union. Not necessarily so. So you can change the courts, you can change parliament, you can change the constitution to make it in accordance with populist demands. But in general, the liberal institutions are distrusted. And there is this promise to take back control. People who are not represented are given the promise that the populist leader will give them back control over their country and their nation and their identity. So I will discuss now some rhetorical devices used in populist discourse. It's a selection. There are many more figures I could discuss, but I think these are quite obvious. Humor would be a different topic. I won't go into that, but that's also something worth studying, I think. So you have the antithesis, the synecdoche, the post-prototo, and the part that stands for the whole, the hyperbole, the exaggeration, in other words, simplification, and a lot of use of the fallacies. I give you, just to get a flavor, I give you some examples. Of course, antithesis is in the heart of populist discourse, already mentioned. And there is a huge distinction between us and them, the real people versus the elite or other people who don't really count. Here, Geert Wilders from Holland, from the Freedom Party, makes a distinction between Moroccans and Dutchmen, or new Dutchmen, as the Moroccans are called by some, and he prefers to call them colonists. So we have, on different levels, you have distinctions here. Second device is the synecdoche, the post pro toto, which is, according to Laclau, the key operation of populist discourse. So the part takes over the whole. And Professor Manuel already said that many politicians, or all politicians, use this technique. So that makes also the distinction between populist discourse and other democratic discourse a bit slippery. But here are some clear examples. Chavez from Venezuela said, I'm not an individual, I am the people. So one person stands for the whole. And Trump says that the only important thing is the unification of the people. The other people don't mean anything. So the part of the people, the real people, the original people, the white male people, are and all the whole, they are the people that really count, and the others don't. Hyperbole So there is a PhD thesis written in Holland about Geert Wilders. So on his use of hyperbole, I could give you many, many examples of Geert Wilders. Here's one from Donald Trump, a recent tweet. So he was going to Davos to meet world and business leaders, and he promised to bring good policy, that's all right, and additional hundreds of billions of dollars back to the US. And we are now number one in the universe by far. Not a really modest claim. an example of Geert Wilders, perhaps also funny to mention, is so we have a rule of law system in the Netherlands, but Geert Wilders was very angry that he was persecuted for certain statements he made about Americans. And then he was convicted, he was really inciting hatred in the population, the judge said. And then he said, oh, we have a really bad legal system in Holland. It's even worse than in North Korea. another example, simplification. We have a complex world and we don't have easy solutions to our problems. But in populist discourse, things are made very simple. So also Geert Wilders has an election program consisting of one page. And the only things that he says is that we should get rid of the Islam, we should get rid of the asylum seekers, that's about this. He wants to throw radical Muslims in jail preventively. So these are the three basic topics, and then we will have a good life back in Holland. So here's another quote from Wilders. Everyone should adjust to our dominant culture, and if you don't do it, you will thrown out in 20 years. And then you have the famous quote by Trump, let's build a wall, and we make Mexico pay for it as a solution to immigration. Fallacies, also studied at length by linguists. I give you some examples. So flaws in reasoning, what is very much used in public discourse, ad populum. So you appeal to the people. Many people agree with me, so it's true. Ad hominem, Trump is very well known for offending people. Wilders does the same in the Netherlands, saying bad things about other people. Slippery slope. So if you don't stop Muslims coming to our country, we will have really a breakdown soon. So you had Hitler in the 30s of the last century, and now we have Mohammed, quote from Wilders. Again, and it's really difficult to engage in a rational debate with populist politicians. They are evading the burden of proof, just saying things. False truth claims, alternative truth claims, and that the result of this is minimizing is the room for discussion. I give you an example. It's a bit. Small, I hope you can read it. But the idea is in exchange from parliamentary debate in the Netherlands in 2010 between Geert Wilders and Femke Halsema, who's now mayor of Amsterdam. Then she was the head of the Green Left Party. And Wilders is here quoting or referring to two German politicians, from CSU, Horst Seehofer, and then to Angela Merkel, saying that multiculturalism is out, it's not working, it's a failure, an absolute failure even. And if Ms. Merkel is saying that, it's saying a lot, according to Wilders. And then Femke Halsema tries to get a debate with Wilders, and she's trying to make the general claim, the conclusion of his point, clear. So are you saying Islam does not belong in our country? At least that is what I assume. And then Wilders denies that is that was his claim. And then Femke Halsema says, yeah, but you quote German politicians that say multicultural society is a failure. Is that your opinion or not? No, I only quoted them. And it goes on and on. And the final conclusion is, I just used a quotation, nothing more. So you cannot really enter into a debate, but the suggestion is clear. We shouldn't have multicultural society. So in this way, we are moving to a post-truth society. I don't think it's fact-free, but there are alternative facts, and we don't have a common ground to discuss evidence anymore. So that's really troubling, I think, in our current democracies. In terms of the means of persuasion, distinguished in classical rhetoric, you have three means of persuasion in populist discourse. Pathos and ethos are very important. So there's an appeal to emotion, and the emotions are mostly very negative. It's very anti-other people, anti-elites, anti-foreigners, strangers. It pictures a negative future, a dystopia of our society. So in Western Europe, there's this fear that we will face the decline of the West, total breakdown. And there is a slight sense of hope. If we can stop it, then there's a return to an imagined populist heartland or Heimat, where when the people was really one and homogeneous. In terms of ethos, so the way character is constructed in populist discourse, character of the leader or the character of the nation, you can say when it comes to populist leaders, they really are making a show, and they are really making politics really personal, and they profile themselves as outsiders, as critics of the system, as fighters, and Trump usually refers to his success in business, which was not always the case, but he says, I was always successful, which isn't true, is another hyperbole. His economic success and sexual success translate into political success. He's a macho, so to speak. And then Salvini, who is now not in power, but he will be back, I predict and I fear. But he's a likable guy, and he demonstrates himself as he can fix problems. You can drink, you have a beer with him, you can dance with him on the beach. He's the guy next door. So very accessible. That's part of the ethos of populist politicians. And then logos, I already said there's a lot of fallacies within populist discourse, flaws in the argumentation. Basically, there's a refusal to play what a colleague of mine called the argumentation game, which is the basis of our democracy, and instead of factual claims based on research, there are references to popular belief. So you have epistemological populism. Popular belief, what people believe to be true, is more true or is really true, in contrast to what the scholars claim that is true. And think of the discussion of climate change. So far I've discussed mainly rhetorical operations within text, so that's basically my field, but of course populism as a performance uses other means as well, visual means, as Professor Menu already said, that the use of social media has changed the political landscape, and politicians, they use their body, their pictures a lot in gaining support or binding with their followers. There's a new kid on the block in Dutch politics. Many people, they know Wilders. Probably you will know Wilders. I don't know if you know Thierry Baudet, but he's getting more and more popular and influential. You should focus on him now, I think. And he sent this picture of his holiday in last summer with the text "Release and Reload." A scene of auto-affection, it seems, which gained a lot of attention in Dutch media. So you have this picture, you have this body. It's not political active, but it still has political significance, I would say. And you will probably know the many pictures Salvini has distributed of his visits to the beach as a DJ and drinking with local people. And here he is with his or a girlfriend, I don't know. The final part of my presentation. So I've tried to characterize it, and now I want to discuss the relation between populism, as I understand it, as performance, in relation to democracy. And basically, there are two conceptions of democracy in play. You have a very formal conception, which considers democracy to be basically a decision-making procedure. Every vote counts equally, and the majority decides. And there should be freedom of expression and so on, but no limitations, not so many, at least. And then you have a more substantive conception of democracy, which sees democracy as a community of values, and there should be mutual respect between the different fractions in society. And democracy is not only about the winner takes all or the majority decides, as in the formal conception, but it's also important that minorities are protected. And here you see democracy and rule of law are connected, and it is perhaps an unstable balance, but it's elements of the rule of law are incorporated in this substantive conception. And when you speak about liberal democracy, you find formal and substantive elements combined. So you have a reference to equality, to liberty, but also the recognition of political rights. And it's true that liberalism originally was not really supportive of democracy, but in this idea of liberal democracy, the two ideas are connected in a bricolage, you could say. Building on the more substantive understanding of democracy, you will probably see populist discourse as a threat. A well-known spokesman of this position is Jan Werner Müller. Professor Latour already referred to him in his opening speech. So populism as an exclusionary form of identity politics poses a danger to democracy. And what are these dangers? There's a danger of exclusion. Parts of the population are just not recognized. They are ignored. They are banned from society. There's a strict antagonism between friends and enemies. So in ordinary conception of democracy, you have opponents who can discuss their point of view and see where they can differ. In populist discourse, you have the tendency that enemies are not part of the debate, they're just excluded, and they have to be abolished or annihilated. Personalization, a lot of stress is put on the leader instead of the institutions. There's a monopolization of power. You see it in Hungary, you see it in Poland. And something which I have called instrumentalism. So there is an instrumental relation between populism and democracy, populism and institutionalism. As long as democracy helps then the populace, it's okay, but it has no intrinsic value. It's a means to a certain end, to get power. Coming from another conception of democracy, you can also see some opportunities in populist discourse. And I'm a bit wavering between the two sides. I will come back to that in my conclusion. So Chantal Mouffe, she will defend that also populism can be a means for, or opportunity for the radicalization of democracy, because people who are not having voice yet are getting the opportunity to be presented or represented in the democratic arena. And it is also something that is part, you could say, of politics in general. So there is not a clear distinction between populist and ordinary politics, you could say. Every politician thrives on some kind of distinction. And that's the way to organize people and to give voice to certain interests. And radical democracy is a way, left-wing populism, to have a pluralistic understanding of democracy, inclusionary instead of exclusionary. And following Canovan, I would say that democracy always has these two faces, that normal politics tend to become quite boring and technocratic, and then you need some populist upheaval to get people who are already again involved in a democratic process. So you have to have this redemptive moment in politics that people can feel that they're in charge and have something to say. It's an illusion perhaps, but it's an important illusion to have. I have been working on a volume. It will be published soon. And it's called Vox Populi, and it's a cooperation between linguists and legal theorists. And we have tried to think of some counter strategies, how to curb the dangers of populist discourse. I will just quickly summarize some of the findings. And there's a lot of stress in reverse order from populism on logos. So it's really a rational approach against populism, and whether that can be successful is very doubtful, of course, because populist discourse operates on other levels, I already mentioned. So many of are the contributors to this volume, they say, first we have to understand, analyze populist discourse, how it works, what are its main rhetorical devices, the strategy, the operations, and we should criticize these rhetorical devices. If you, for instance, evade the burden of proof, you're not playing the argumentation game, which is very important for democracy. And another proposal was that we should not only do fact-checking, which is popular now, but we should do also some rhetoric checking. So you have perhaps certain facts, but are they supportive of the claim that you are making? And if you suggest to build a wall against the Mexicans, will that really help to solve the problem of immigration? So that's part of, you could say, what Monk and others have called civic education. We should, again, tell people through our work what is the value of democracy and why, how does democracy function and why we need this culture of argumentation, which is the basis of our liberal democracy. In terms of ethos, you see many contributions in our volume. I wanted to show that the identity constructed by people like Orban and others were fake or fake identities, or Erdogan in Turkey, that they were used for political purposes. So there was a deconstruction of the means used to construe identity. And I already said, you can also suggest alternative ways to think about identity in terms of a dynamic identity, something that will develop in time, so you're not white male forever. The society is not only based on white males, but it will change, it has changed, and it will change in the future. And so it's a way to think differently about identity. And the last part, the pathos part, it's about emotions. So many people contributing to the volume said, yeah, of course, emotions is part of politics. You should not ban emotions from politics. Some theorists do that, but that's not okay. It is better to use the emotions. They are part of or recognize emotions, and they are part of legitimate interests. So much is more about how do you manage anger. There is anger about many things. And there is fear about the loss of identity, the fear of loss of finance and so on. So you should really take these fears and the anger seriously, but that does not mean that you should accept the populist solution suggested as a response to these outbursts of anger. So this is something what Freud would call an act of sublimation. So in the end, it's, the strategies could be a combination of inclusion. Some of the populist themes are recognized, but also the way they are addressed, they are is excluded. So you try somehow to cooperate populist themes within political thought without subduing yourself to the populist logic by excluding people and creating the illusion that the popular will can be transmitted directly. In conclusion, so I consider populism to be a double-edged sword. It has the promise of the renewal of democracy. It gives voice to people who feel or are really excluded in the current system. It has dangerous sides to it because it has this totalitarian logic into it that it excludes other people who don't count as the real people, and it has this illusion in it that the people's will can be presented directly. I think democracy is always representation, and populism denies that. But populism reminds us that in politics, the form, politics is a kind of performance, and form matters, political style matters. So it's also a warning against European Union and technocratic government. It's important that power is embodied and that principles are carried out. So in terms of the three means of persuasion of rhetoric, I would say it's important on the level of logos that we should defend as if we want to support liberal democracy, the defend of its basic principles, equality, liberty, solidarity, embodied power. So leadership is important, responsive and inspiring leadership, what Buchenforde has called the ethos of legality, that you really show that you have respect for the institutions and subjugate yourself to the institutions, even though the outcome is not pleasant to you. If you're convicted by the judge, for instance, like in Wilders' case, you should accept that as part of the ethos of legality. And we should also stress the values we share as something worth striving for. We should have a passion for freedom, diversity, and pluralism. That's the pathos side. Buchenforde also said that liberty is seductive, but I think we could stress that and make it clear why it's a seductive ideal also to have a pluralist society. So the utopian dimension of the rule of law is important. That's something I'm studying in another article I'm writing now. So there must be a promise of secular redemption, as Canavan said. And that means that we also should address some of the teleocratic sentiments that are an important part of populist discourse. That means that we should take seriously the longing for identity, the longing for safety, but that we also give a positive message of hope. So I would conclude, don't look back in anger, let's imagine a future that is hopeful, even in times of crisis. Thank you very much.